So, like for most of the people, it's this way that they're like this earlier, then they go to gym and they use barbells and they become like this. For me, it's the other way around. So nevertheless, so it's a fun reading, also a little complex, like very conceptual reading. But the benefit of this is once you are conceptually okay, then you don't need to memorize it. So if you see this image on my deck, this image is kind of summary of 70 to 80% of the reading. And you would really appreciate this image when I finish it. So for the timing, what you need to remember is that we have a barbell, and that barbell is used to make this fat guy flat. So if you kind of remember, barbell and flat is going to make things much more easier for us when we go forward. So let's get started. So here is what we're going to do in this reading. It talks about active portfolio management in fixed income. And active portfolio management essentially means trying to outperform the benchmark. So trying to outperform the benchmark could happen on multiple parameters. It could happen because you have an opinion on yield, or it could happen because you have an opinion on sectors. Do you agree? Here we're not worried about sectors so much. Here we're looking at active portfolio management from a yield curve perspective, which basically means, are you expecting yield curves to change their shape? And if yes, depending on what is your expectation, what positions you would try to build there. So this is portfolio versus benchmark. And of course, what we would be trying to do here is we would try to outperform. Now, in the introduction stage, curriculum says that an active strategy does not always mean that there is a very high turnover in your portfolio. An active strategy doesn't have to be a active strategy could also be a buy and hold strategy, which basically means it is not necessary that if you are following an active portfolio management process, there is going to be a significant turnover. But right, here's your section two. Now I'll leave you with this for a minute. I want you to read this and then we will discuss this one by one. Are we done with this? Are you finished reading? Then I'll explain one by one. I'll tell you what is to be written. Okay, so let's focus on this first. We kind of doing the basic concepts of yield curve dynamics. And I'm first going to finish this green box in between, which basically says you can forecast three possible type of movements in a yield curve. Okay, so a typical yield curve should look like this. Let's say a normal yield curve is like this. Now, what kind of movements can we expect? So what if your revised yield curve becomes like this? So this is a parallel move, and this is referred to as change in the level. So this is the change in the level. Or if your yield curve is like this and your revised yield curve becomes like this. So when your revised yield curve is moving like this, we will say that this is a change in the slope. We also call this as twist. And then we would be looking at the flattening twist and the steepening twist. And then curvature. So your yield curve is like this. And maybe your revised yield curve becomes like this. It's a different color. Your revised yield curve becomes like this. So now what has happened is, there is a change in the curve of this particular yield curve, which is your point number three here. Now, what we would be learning today is we would be learning how to deal with them in isolation, in terms of how do you book your trades when there is a change in level, vis-a-vis change in slope or vis-a-vis change in curvature. And then we would also look at some of the situations where what if all the three things are happening together. Now, what curriculum says is, in general, these changes do not occur in isolation. It's not that you would just have a shift in the yield curve. In general, you would observe that all the three things are happening together, which means there might be a change in level, and at the same time there would be a change in slope and maybe even curvature. Are we okay with this part? Then there is a discussion on the spread, and how would you calculate this spread? So you would calculate this spread with this formula. No. Absolutely, yeah. So here, okay, good question. Question he asks, is this a credit spread? No. This is a spread of different maturities. Okay, and primarily we are talking about treasuries at this moment. Okay, so when I say spread here, it essentially means the difference between the yields of two different maturities. So how do you calculate this spread? So one way of doing it is, you find out the yield on 30-year bond and you remove a yield on short maturity bond. We'll typically use a 2-year bond here. So yield on a 30-year bond and a yield on a 2-year bond. Now generally you would want this number to be positive, correct? Because you would hope for a normal yield curve like this. If the yield curve is inverted, then this number is going to be negative. This is roughly, you can get a sense on the slope of the yield curve. Now this is what I want to know, I mean, this is what you want, I want you to focus on. If that spread has widened, then the yield curve has become more steep. If the spread has narrowed, then the yield curve has become more flatter. Is that making sense to you? So the first thing you would remember is, and maybe you should write this down. So first write down slope of the yield curve. Write down slope of the yield curve formula, which is yield on 30-year bond minus yield on a short maturity bond. In bracket, you can also say spread. Slope or spread, so yield on 30-year bond minus yield on a short maturity bond. Okay, and then you can say if it widens, that means increases, then we have a more steeper yield curve. If it widens or increases, we have a more steeper yield curve. Are we all right here? Then of course a negative value of the spread would result into a inverted yield curve. And then to capture the curvature, we would look at something called as a butterfly spread, which will come very soon. So to capture the slope, we are going to use this formula, and to capture the curvature, we are going to calculate the butterfly spread. Now some of the additional points. In general, when we are referring to yield curve, the most common reference is of course YTMs. Correct. So the treasury yield curve that we see on the US Treasury website, we are referring to YTMs. But yield curves could also be referred, it's kind of a generic term, and it could also used to refer par rates or spot rates or forward rates. So in this reading, most of the time when they're saying yield curve, they actually mean YTMs. But there could be situations where yield curve could also be used for either of these situations. Then if you have a inverted yield curve, then of course the spread is going to be negative. This part we've covered. And then there is some decent discussion in the curriculum about the negative interest rate world. And then they discuss that if in future there are bonds which have negative coupons. If in future there are bonds which have negative coupons, what would a negative coupon would mean? The investor will be required to pay the coupon. If that happens, then in those situations, it is quite possible that duration will turn out to be greater than maturity. Because in general, we know that durations are, come on, modified duration, even for a coupon bond, durations are lesser than maturity. But if the coupons are negative, it might get inverted. This is not for example, this is just, they say that if that happens. So this is just for us to think about. Okay, so now I'll give you a minute, you can read through this and then you can ask me questions. Two ways, the investor needs to pay. So question she asked, if coupon is negative, there is a two-way credit exposure. So the investor needs to pay the coupon. That's one credit exposure. And the issuer needs to pay back your face value. That's second credit exposure. Are you cool with this? Nice. Okay. So how are you going to measure the curvature of the yield curve? So roughly, if you think of this as a yield curve, then some reference point that we typically use is we use 2 years for the short end of the yield curve. To look at the middle, we look at about 10 years, and the long end of the yield curve, we look at 30 years. Now, in a way, when you want to look at the curvature, what you basically want to know is you want to look at short end versus the midpoint versus the long end, and then this is how you measure that butterfly spread. So butterfly spread is, I'll give you time to write, just focus. You take the middle yield, you multiply that with 2, and then you remove short-term yield from it and you remove long-term yield. And then if there is a more curvature, you would end up having substantially larger positive value for butterfly spreads. So by looking at butterfly spread, you can get a sense on how curved your yield curve is. Is that okay?